Yeah, I'm live on Facebook.
And we are live on YouTube. So let's get started. Good morning. Welcome on the first Sunday of the month to Chai and Wai. We should have been at our usual venue, Prithvi Theatre. We were very glad to be back to physical sessions finally this year. But unfortunately, this session is again an online only session. And thank you so much for watching it online. I really apologize that we are not at Prithvi. I really thank the Prithvi organizers and the staff for this very, very last minute change. We've unfortunately been hit by a few COVID cases. The city also, the numbers are going up. And in particular, our own outreach team, some of the staff have not able to make it there. So we thought we should be absolutely safe and do this online. So here we are in our respective houses. Unfortunately, there'll be no chai, but hopefully you can make your own cup of chai and join in with us. Chai nahi hai to theek hai, but there's going to be lots of food for thought. Because today's session commemorates International Women's Day, which is tomorrow actually. And you know, anyway, first, in case anybody's watching this for the first time, Chai and Wai happens on the first Sunday, the third Sunday, and if a month has a fifth Sunday, the fifth Sunday of the month. And we are, you know, always online these days, which have something interesting from the world of science to talk about. And today's session is going to be by Professor Vandana Nanal. She is a nuclear physicist, but also very, very passionate about promoting the cause of women in STEM. And she has some wonderful stories to tell us about women in science, especially the forgotten ones whose stories we may not know about. So with this little introduction, I'm going to hand it over to her. But before that, please remember, we can't see you. So the only way we can interact with you, and we would like to make this interactive, is if you're watching us on YouTube or Facebook, please put in your comments, type them out on the chat box or the comments box. If you're watching on the Zoom webinar, please use the Q&A box or the chat box, and we will try and take the comments. We'll try and keep this as informal as possible. So with that, over to you, Vandana. I'm going to spotlight your video. You might want to share your, you know, say something and then eventually share your screen and check that. That's okay.
Yes. Thank you, Arnab, for the inviting me for this wonderful session of Chai and Wai. As you said that, yes, it's something which is a subject which is close to my heart. And we are going to miss Chai, but let's hope we will have lots of Wai, as you say. So greetings on, let me share my screen now. I hope you all can see my screen. One minute. Is the screen visible?
Yes.
Okay. So the title is The Saga of Unsung Heroes. On the eve of International Women's Day, warm greetings. As you know that one of the reasons such days are marked and such occasions are celebrated is to get like a corrective action. It has been traditionally the science was thought to be as the field of men, and of course there has been a struggle many years for, and it's not only for women and girls to say that we are equal, hum kisi se kam nahi, so try to prove that. But it is more of the community, the society recognizing the talent, appreciating it and utilizing it. So in addition to the International Women's Day, some of you may know that United Nations actually declared February 11 as the International Day of Women and Girls in Science. So today's session, what I want to do is tell you a story about the struggle and achievements, because it's not just the struggle, people do make it to the top, and how they achieve that is some of the stories which I'll try to tell you. So that's where it should be, it's not really a science, I mean, it's not a science talk, it's just a story of how people struggled and how motivated they were. I hope through these stories to motivate and provide inspiration to some of the listeners, and that will go a long way in contributing. As I just mentioned, 11th February has been declared as International Day of Women and Girls in Science since 2016. One of the purpose of the main reason behind it is that this significant gender gap persists in STEM, that is the science, technology and mathematics, all over the world. And it's not just that the women are left out, it's also a loss to the society, because about 50% of the people are left out, so we are missing out on their contribution. So what do we do? If we go back and look at it, you know, the Nobel Prize is one of the highest honors in the science, and it was instituted in 1900, and there have been several hundreds of prizes since then in different disciplines. So if you look at the science disciplines and you look at the situation till about 2015, there were 11 women in medicine, 4 in chemistry and 2 in physics who got Nobel Prizes. That's what I mean by Nobel women. And if we look now in 2020, there are 12 women who have got Nobel Prize in medicine, 7 in chemistry and 4 in physics. So as you see, the number in chemistry and physics has almost doubled in the last 5 years. It's not that suddenly the women have sprung in action, but it's also partly something which that their work has started getting a recognition. And many factors contribute to that. When we listen to their stories, we will understand some of these factors. Or at least I'll highlight some of these factors. So the 4 women in physics who got Nobel Prizes are Marie Curie. She was the first woman to get the Nobel Prize in any branch. Then Maria Goeppert-Mayer in 1963, Donna Strickland in 2018, and Andrea Ghez in 2020 in physics. So if we look at Marie Curie, she is a very, very unique person in many ways. So she got the first Nobel Prize in 1903 for research in radioactivity. This she shared with her husband and Henri Becquerel. Many of you may not know that when the Nobel Prize candidates were nominated for the research in radioactivity, although she was one of the first persons who had done a lot of pioneering work in that area, she was left out. It was only her husband Pierre Curie and Henri Becquerel who were nominated. When Pierre Curie came to know about it, he actually approached the relevant people and said, either you include her or you leave me out, because the work would not have been possible without her, and she must be included if the credit has to be given to that. So it was only at his insistence she got included, and she rightfully got the Nobel Prize. In fact, this just doesn't stop here. It went further. She was not made a member of the French Science Academy because, again, women were not allowed. And Pierre Curie declined the membership of the academy for the same reason, saying that she is more deserving, and if she doesn't get it, I don't want to be there. She was very, very fortunate to have such a strong support from her husband. She got a second Nobel Prize in chemistry in 1911 for the discovery of radium and polonium. And she's the only woman till today, or in fact the only person till today, to get Nobel Prizes in 2 different branches. Her daughter went on to win the Nobel Prize in chemistry in 1935, which she won with shared with her husband Federico Joliot Curie for the artificial radioactivity. That means creating unstable nuclei with reactions in the laboratory. So Curies are the family with the most Nobel laureates to date. And if you count, so they have 5 prizes among them, and if you count the son-in-law, that will be 6. Coming to the chemistry, again, since there are so few, I can just go through the names. So the first one to get Nobel Prize was a British chemist in 1964, Dorothy Hodgkin. Then came in 2009, Ada Yonath. She was from Israel. Then you had Frances Arnold in 2018. And this year's prize was given jointly to Emmanuel Carpentier and Jennifer Doudna. Now I have this slide and I would like to ask a question. I hope you all can see this. I would like you to identify 3 women scientists from this slide. You have some about 20 names here, 15-20 names. And can you identify 3 women scientists? Please type into the chat box and I will wait for a couple of minutes for the response. let me see if I can open the chat box and see. Okay. There is one answer which says all are, I think, and that is the correct answer. These all are women scientists, and I'll show you quickly a slide to show what areas they worked in. So this is kind of tells you some of them are physicists, some of them are chemists, astronomers, biochemists, mathematics, and computers. Ada Lovelace made the first analytical machine for the computer. Before I move further, I would like to mention Maryam Mirzakhani. She is the mathematics Fields Medal winner. She is the only woman to get the Fields Medal, and this is the highest prize in mathematics equivalent to Nobel Prize, and she comes from Iran. She's also rather young. So these are at least, these are people who have struggled a lot and reached a stage, but people come to know about them because of their achievement. And now there are many who are not so well known. So there are many among that. And in this next half an hour, I will try to tell you the stories of the four: Agnes Spockels, Lisa Meitner, Jocelyn Bell Burner, and C.S. Wu. Some of you may have heard about them, but I will now go tell the stories about their work. The choice is purely personal. I am a physicist, so I have picked up a few physicists. And then there is something more that has gone in, which once I tell their stories at the end, I will summarize telling you that why these four. So let's start with Agnes Spockels. Agnes Spockels did not have a formal education. She was a Jew, came from a Jew family. She was the eldest daughter of a very large family. So after she finished the school, and the parents were not keeping well, so after she finished the school, she had to do what the eldest daughter of the house has to do. Even today, in many cases, is that take care of all the household chores. So the cooking and washing, and this is in the end of the 19th century. So you have to imagine the life was hard. It was not all gadgets were not there. And so that is what she was doing. Her younger brother was studying physics at the university. In that era, the girls were not allowed to go to university in Austria in the before 1900. And then, because when she was to do her household chores, that wash the vessels and so on after the dinner is over, she would study with her brother and do this work. So in fact, this is what I would like to read out from her biographical note, which came about, is that their studies were often conducted in the kitchen, where Agnes, being the daughter of the household, had to do her chores, and where it was always nice and warm. That's another thing, because the kitchen was a warm place. In this way, Agnes conducted her first observations in the field of surface science. In fact, the field of surface science is said to have begun with some of her work. This is really true, no joke or poetic license. What millions of women see every day without pleasure and are anxious to get rid of, that is the greasy washing up water, encourage this girl to make observations and eventually do scientific investigations. So while washing, while looking at the grease films, oil films, she would make observations, make notes in her notebook. And this she did for a very long time, almost 10 years. Then what happened was, she came across a paper published by Lord Rayleigh. And encouraged by that paper, she actually put together all her work. This was written in German, and sent it to him. And the part of her letter is reproduced here. My Lord, will you kindly excuse me my venturing to trouble you with a German letter or a scientific subject? Having heard of the fruitful researches carried on by you last year on the hitherto little understood properties of water surfaces, I thought it might interest you to know of my own observations on the subject. For various reasons, I am not in a position to publish them in scientific periodicals, and I therefore adopt this means of communicating to you the most important of them. I thought I ought not to withhold from you these facts which I have observed. Although I am no professional physicist, and again begging you to excuse my boldness, I remain with sincere respect. So she wrote this German letter. Now I would like to add here that it was good that this was an era before the computers. Today, people, if such a mail had come, it might have ended in the spam box. But Rayleigh received this letter. He went through the thing and he was very impressed with the work. So he got it translated and then he encouraged her to write this to Nature. Nature is one of the highest rated journals in the scientific world. It is also the results of great significance get published here. So, and he in fact forwarded this with a note saying that I shall be obliged if you can find the space for the accompanying translation of an interesting letter which I have received from a German lady who with very homely appliances, that is just washing dishes, with very homely appliances has arrived at valuable results respecting the behavior of contaminated water surfaces. The earlier part of Ms. Pockel's letter covers nearly the same ground as some of my own recent work and in the main harmonizes with it. The latter section seems to me very suggestive, raising, if they do not fully answer, many important questions. I hope you soon to find opportunity for repeating some of Ms. Pockel's experiments. After this recommendation, the work of Agnes Pockels was published in Nature in 1891. The 10 years of research came out in one paper. And some of her later work highlights are the solutions of sugar have a normal surface and a higher surface tension than pure water. Yet a piece of sugar brought to its surface causes material current and surface tension reduction. Some of this may be technical, but I have just put it here to give you a flavor of her work. So in a nutshell, her studies form the basis for quantitative studies of surface science. In fact, the device which is called Langmuir device, which is used for measuring surface tension, the concept design of her was given to that. Today, the surface science is one of very, very important branches of science and a lot of research goes on in this area. This is the picture of her home. And this is the note which she made that encouraged by the support of Lord Rayleigh and the publications in Nature, I dared to submit papers to German journals and conducted about 10 years of successful investigations. The care of my sick parents was very challenging. Therefore, after 1902, I did very few experiments, but I did a translation and wrote comments for the journal, which my brother edited. In 1909, I published my observations on the contact angle. After that, her brother was called for had to join the World War I. So her contact with the academic world actually dwindled away. And unfortunately, her brother was killed later in the war. I do not recall whether the First or the Second World War, but he was killed. And that was kind of end of her association with the world of science. Moving on to another Austrian geophysicist, Lise Meitner. She was born in 1968, a little younger than Agnes Pockel, had a very supportive family. She got her initial education in Austria and again had the similar problem that after she was 14, after she finished the school finals, she had to study from home. She actually prepared and gave her university entrance exam from home and cleared it. So she went to the university in 1901. As I mentioned, till 1900, the women were not allowed to go to university in Austria. When she went to university and she got the doctorate in 1906, she was only second woman to get a doctorate from Austria. I think the first one was somebody in philology. And that was given in 1901. But after that, she moved to Germany for higher studies and eventually she had to move out of Germany to Sweden in the World War II because she was Jew. But let's look at her journey. When she came to Germany, she struggled to find a job, a paid position. She could not find it for a long time. So the family actually supported her stay in Germany for a very, very long time. She translated scientific articles from German to English to earn her living. In 1912, she got the first paid position as assistant to a famous physicist, Max Planck, for grading students' papers. She became the first woman to become professor in Germany in 1919, and in 1922, she qualified for university teaching. So 1926, she became first university professor also in Germany. In the First World War, she worked as an X-ray technician. When she came to Germany, the field of nuclear physics, the radioactivity, was very, very young. Hardly anything new known in nuclear physics. The nuclear concept of atoms, nuclear radioactivity was just discovered. Remember, Marie Curie got Nobel Prize in 1903. So she was very impressed. She liked the maths and physics as a child, but when she went to the university, she discovered that she likes physics. And the person she worked with, the scientist, was setting up the radioactivity lab, so that interested her more. So when she moved to Germany, she started working with that. She met Otto Hahn, who was a chemist, and the Hahn-Meitner combination got together, and they worked till 1940s together on many, many aspects. In fact, during the First World War, when Hahn went on to serve on the military duty, she continued the experiments. And she published the work under the authorship of both Hahn and Meitner, something which she was deprived of in the later years. So when she actually was looking for a position and even to work, when she did not have the paid position, just to do the research work, it was very hard for her to find a place to work. So at that time, there was this chemistry institute, and finally she was given the permission to work there. But women were not allowed, so she was not allowed to use the main entrance. She had to work in the basement. The lab was set up in the basement carpenter shop. She was to use the side entrance. There were no women toilet for her in the institute. So she had to go out of the institute, walk across the road, down the road to a nearby hotel where she could go to the toilet. I mentioned this because this was very hard. It is in the winters. You have to do this. And in somewhere, if I get time there later, I would say the situations in even for the Indian students which they face in many of the undergraduate and graduate studies. So one of the major drawbacks of working in the basement laboratory, she didn't complain. She was a very shy and a dedicated person. She tried to work there. Now, when you work in the basement, typically in the basements, there is a radioactive contaminant called radon, which comes from natural radioactivity, which interferes with the measurement. So she had a tough time working there, but she continued. But one of the major drawbacks was that she was mostly left out of scientific discussions. Because consider, she was working in isolation. If there are visitors, if there were students and professors, how do we discuss? We find something interesting, you go for tea together, you meet in the corridors, you discuss, and then the discussions progress, people know about your work, you know about their work, you can get ideas to do further work. All of this academic atmosphere she was left out of. And that's really, really a pity. Not just that, there were no women in the academics. So when they had even distinguished visitors, she mentions in one of the episodes that Rutherford was visiting. Rutherford is known as a father of nuclear physics. He was a director of Cavendish Lab and he was visiting Germany. So exciting discussions. But he had come with his wife. And somehow in the group, even with all the very, very well-known scientists and all that, it was automatically that she was keeping company to Rutherford's wife. She was trying the job of keeping, entertaining Rutherford's wife, Philip. So it's something which is, you know, happens not because necessarily because of conscious bias. It happens because of unconscious bias. And it keeps happening even today to many. But this is something which puts the woman scientist, and particularly for a person like her, put at a great disadvantage. She did many nuclear physics experiments, many things in the early days of radioactivity she has discovered and remained hidden, because many things like Auger effect she discovered in parallel, but she didn't get credit for that. So one of the things which she is very known for today is the nuclear fission. And it's a long story, so I will take a few minutes to tell this story. You know what the phenomena of nuclear fission is like? The heavy nuclei like uranium can be broken into two fragments. Now, this after the discovery of artificial radioactivity, which I just told you in the beginning, that Irene Joliet Curie got the Nobel Prize for, where they showed that by reactions of neutron or alpha particles, you can create new elements with a different combinations of neutrons and protons inside the nucleus, which are not stable. So they decay, they undergo radioactive decay. But the concept that if you hit any element, so there were many experiments done in Italy. In fact, even Fermi was doing this experiment. And now it is believed that when he was the Nobel Prize, which he got for creating for new elements, is actually also the fission phenomenon. So they were taking very slow neutrons, very slow moving neutrons, and then bombard them on this new in the heavy nuclei. The idea was that it will capture a neutron and will make a nearby new radioactive element. Nobody imagined that if you take a neutron and hit a nucleus like uranium, the uranium nucleus will break into two parts. So when and how do you identify these elements? These were done by chemistry. You kind of chemically separate them. So some of these techniques of separating elements, collecting the products, is all these new techniques also were developed by Lisa Meitner. So when they were looking at the products, and you when you do chemical analysis, you know that the different elements in a given column of the periodic table show similar properties. So when they saw some elements like barium like properties, they felt it should be radium, because the radium is close by to uranium and it has similar products like barium. So even when because it was unimaginable, unthinkable to think that uranium, so by a small neutron tickling uranium, you will generate barium. So this work actually started in early 30s, and it was only in 1938 they could conclusively prove that this was the element barium. So these experiments, that these should conclusively, the chemistry experiment should be done to make the identity, identify the elements. This, the brain behind this was also Lisa Meitner. But in mid of 1935, as the situation in Germany was deteriorating, she had to leave. She kept on working because she was aloof and she thought that this will not touch her. She was in a science institute and everybody cared about science and so on. But the things were getting difficult. Her colleagues recognized it and thankfully got her out of Germany before things became very difficult. She literally had to live with her handbag because she had come to the office and she left the institute under the pretext just showing that she's going somewhere nearby. She moved. Yes.
If I may interrupt you, I think from 1935, even though the Jewish professors had to leave, she was saved because she was an Austrian citizenship. Because she was a foreigner, she was saved. But in 1938, once Austria got annexed, that was a point where suddenly there was, you know, she was found herself in trouble and had to sort of pretty much leave right away.
Yes. Thanks, Arnab. That is true, because initially she kept that her Austrian citizenship protected her. But as the things worsened, even her passport taken away. And then, so initially she felt that, yes, she was protected and things were there. But she also felt that the colleagues around her were protective of her, which were large extent it was true.
That is true.
In a big institute, you never know. I should perhaps mention at this point that when she got the paid job, it was a newly made institute, which was then called Kaiser Wilhelm Institute. And there they had basically the separate chemistry and physics lab. So both Hahn and Meitner were working there. And then, but it was true that, you know, in a big institute, the information was getting passed out and she just left with her handbag. She had to leave all, not her belongings. She had to leave a lot of her science and the laboratory behind. And that made her feel very, very uprooted. Otto Hahn gave her his wedding ring with her. So that when she was, she was effectively smuggled out to Netherlands by the train, and this was that in required, she was to use that ring for bribing the police on the way. Thankfully, she didn't have to do that and she reached the Holland safely, and from there she went on to Sweden. In Sweden, she joined the institute where Sigman, another very, very well-known scientist, was a director. He also had a major role in the Nobel committees. but he was very strongly prejudiced against women, and that made her life very difficult. She later came back to Germany for visits, but never to stay. But that's the story for the later part. So when in 19th, so the experiments continued. She stayed in touch with Otto Hahn via via letters, but she got left out of the work from that point, which is unfortunate. So the story that the explanation of the fission came to her in a very, very interesting episode, and that I will tell you now, that in the December of 38, her nephew Otto Robert Frisch, who also a nuclear physicist, was visiting her, and they were spending Christmas vacation together. He was at that time, I think, in Oxford or in Copenhagen. So because after the vacation, when he went back, he met Niels Bohr. So solution to this mystery of nuclear physics came during a long walk in the woods. On the Christmas, in this vacation, they were walking, taking this walk in the snow, discussing physics, and suddenly it struck to Lise Meitner that the nucleus is a highly charged wobbly liquid drop which breaks into two nearly equal sized drops when even disturbed slightly. And just sitting on a tree trunk, she did this quick calculation and estimated the amount of energy released in such a breakup. And she said that is a 200 mega electron volt, mega electron volt are the units used by nuclear and particle physicists. And even today, that's a very, very accurate estimation, accurate calculation, I would say. And then, of course, they wrote the paper, Nature paper, saying what the physics. So the physics of the process, she explained. She was involved in getting these experiments initiated, involved in the directing those experiments, and yet she remained out of the recognition of the Nobel Prize for the fission, which was given in 1944 for Otto Hahn. There was a lot of debate whether it was because it was a chemistry or a physics work, or because of the interdisciplinary work it got left out. It also, I think, Sigban played a role because of his prejudice. It's so, in fact, in her case, it worked out like she was a Jew, she was an immigrant, she was interdisciplinary, and just it's very, very unfortunately just got left out of one of the major discoveries. But I want to tell a little more about her story here. So after the forced immigration, as I said, she felt completely uprooted. Coming back to the discovery of the fission, as one can see that it was a teamwork involving chemistry and physics, but somehow this point was lost during the award of Nobel Prize. Unfortunately, for a long time, her independent work explaining fission was ignored, her role in collaborative work undervalued. She was always treated as a woman subordinate to a man in collaboration, even though she has been described by some group members as the intellectual leader of the team. I put this here because I feel that this is a common disease spread everywhere, almost like a COVID-19. Even today, many of the women scientists face this problem. Many of the women, if they are working together with their husband because they're in same area, it would always be the husband doesn't have to do something extra to prove that he has done the work. But a wife will have to do something extra to show that she is an independent worker. She later got many recognitions. One of the main things she got was the prestigious Fermi Prize for pioneering research in naturally occurring radioactivity and extensive experimental studies leading to nuclear fission. The release of relevant documents of Nobel Foundation in 1990s, which is done after 50 years, have further strengthened the view of the scientific community that her exclusion was unjust. This was published in Physics Today. Many of you can look up this on the... So I will now end her story by two citations. So one, what she said about science. Science makes people reach selflessly for truth and objectivity. It reaches people to accept reality with wonder and admiration, not to mention the deep awe and joy that natural order of things brings to the true scientist. As I said, she did many, many things in science. One of the things was she also estimated the age of the Earth looking at the lead isotope distribution. She has got one rare honor, she's the only woman besides Marie Curie to get this honor, is that the element 109 is named after her, Meitnerium. In 1958, Nuclear Physics Institute in Berlin was named as a Hahn Meitner Institute. Now, in fact, it has got merged into something else. So, to summarize and to conclude her story, her journey started in Austria, where opportunities of higher education for women were very limited. Her passion for science was very strong, and she pursued the same in spite of enormous socio-political obstacles. She will be remembered as one of the most significant women scientists of the 20th century, a role model for many generations, very true. Known as the mother of nuclear power, she refused to work on the Manhattan Project for atomic bomb. I think this is something which people should note and remember and appreciate. She was a strong believer of the use of nuclear energy for peaceful purposes. The inscription on her tombstone by her nephew is a fitting tribute. Lisa Meitner, a physicist who never lost her humanity. I now move on to my third woman scientist of today, Jocelyn Bellburn.
Maybe we should just take a quick poll and ask if people have questions at this point on either Meitner or, you know, something that was discussed earlier before we move on. Just in case somebody wants to ask a quick question. Let me just see if there are any comments on the YouTube channel. There doesn't seem to be anything here. And no hands up on Zoom. Nope, no hands, no comments. Okay, I think we should go on then. And of course, feel free, please feel free to you know, stop and ask questions. We would like to make this interactive and informal.
Yeah,
go ahead.
So Jocelyn Bell Burnell is a British physicist and belongs to the later half of the century. So as I said that I have picked up the woman with some commonalities sometimes, and what I want to highlight is that even with the changing times, the struggle which they had to go through has not changed significantly, at least till the stories we hear about. Of course, the things are improving and the speed is, the slope is slow, but I hope definitely things are much better for us today than those days. So Jocelyn Bell Burnell was the first astronomer to detect the pulsars. The pulsars are rapidly rotating neutron stars, so you get kind of pulses, radio wave pulses at a very periodic time, and that's something which opened up a new avenue in the astronomy, astrophysics, and that also led to the enhanced understanding of the stellar regulation. So she built this radio telescope herself for this detection. And I was fortunate in a few years back when she visited India, we actually were fortunate enough to listen to her story of the discovery as well as her current work and again her views on that. So what happened was she discovered these pulses, but the Nobel Prize was given to her advisor. She was excluded from the Nobel Prize. Again, something which is extremely admirable in her, which I found, was that her interviews and the tapes and the stories are available on the web, you can look up, is that the rationality with which she has looked at the whole episode and carried on. I mean, since I had an opportunity to see her, I really, really find this very impressive that she is no better. And her explanation for this is given here. But before I tell that, I want to tell that how the analysis of the thing happened. So she actually saw this pulses in the Christmas vacation when everybody else had gone for Christmas and she was struggling very hard to complete the work. And when that happened, she of course shared this with her supervisor, and then when they came back, the experiment had to be repeated, things had to be looked at, and according to her, this was again one of the things which was, because it was not an automated analysis, it was a human eye looking for it, and so somehow she still believes that I also tend to agree with her that, you know, you are more sensitive to it than looking at the things from that, because it's possible that a computer may have missed it, or okay, now with a modern thing you would have picked out, but still what a human brain can do cannot be a complete substitute. So what the story which she told was, so when of course the result were confirmed that it was true, then there were a lot of excitement and discussion, and one day she was going to her advisor's room and she found that they were in deep discussions with other people. And nobody had, even when she of course knocked in and walked in, then they asked her to stay. But it was her work, her thesis work. She had found something good. She had also recognized that this was something out of ordinary and put forward to that. And when the related discussion happens, she was not even called. Because she was passing by the way, yes, join in was there. And this is, just remember a few slides ago, I told you about Lisa Meitner. Was left out of discussions. And this continued even here also. So that's something which is there that you feel bad about. But as I said, that she has gone on to do a very, very creditable work later. Later, she is given the British honor of Dame, which is like also one of the main honors, like in civil, one of the civil honors. And what, so she says this very nicely about the Nobel Prize thing. She says, there are several comments that I would like to make on this. First, the demarcation disputes between the supervisor and the student are always difficult, probably impossible to resolve. Secondly, it is the supervisor who has the final responsibility for the success or failure of the project. We hear of cases where a supervisor blames his student for failure, but we know that it is largely the fault of the supervisor. It seems only fair to me that he should benefit from the successes too. Thirdly, I believe that it would demean Nobel Prizes if they were awarded to research students, except in very exceptional cases, and I do not believe this is one of them. Finally, I am not myself upset about it. After all, I am in a good company, am I not? So very humble, very nice way to look at it and move on. So I thought I will share with all of you here. Now it brings me to the last case of today's, and that is C.S. Wu. She is a nuclear physicist, and she was a Chinese scientist moved to America, working in the U.S. in one of the University of Columbia, one of the very top places. What she showed was that through her experiments, that mirror image of beta decay is different. I don't want to make it too technical. I just want to tell you very briefly that we know that inside the atom, there's a nucleus, and inside nucleus, there are neutrons and protons, and the negatively charged electrons move around the nucleus. These neutrons are not stable. They themselves undergo a decay process. So neutrons themselves are radioactive, and they decay into a proton, an electron, and a third particle called antineutrino. So this process is the beta decay, because Henry Becquerel had discovered the X-rays, and then people discovered this beta radiation, and later it was found that this beta originates from the neutron to proton. So Madam Wu did very extensive experiments on the beta decay, and she was working on that when one day the two theoreticians discussing about some puzzle in physics. So theoretician Li walked to her and asked her, can she test a fundamental theory of the parity? What is the parity? The parity refers to the mirror reflection symmetry. We know that if we take our right hand or a left hand and the mirror, it changes to the left or right respectively. In nature also, there are molecules, there are objects. We ourselves are not mirror symmetric. We have the heart to the left, and when if I take a mirror reflection, the reflection will have therefore heart to the right. But the most of the basic physics laws, basic science laws as we know, are most of them were mirror symmetric. At least in the mid 50s, nothing was known to violate this symmetry or break this symmetry. The scientists call a symmetry breaking when the two images will not have a similar behavior. And she did this experiment to study the beta decay. She did this with a cobalt 60. Cobalt is the has a special properties because it can be magnetized. And she did this using some very clever experimental tricks. So the entire thought that the when Li asked her a question, can we study this? Can we study whether the parity is violated or not in the beta decay? The experiment to study the beta decay, which will allow you to mimic the properties of mirror imaging. She mimicked this by using the cobalt, and therefore by applying magnetic field. So magnetic field, you can reverse the direction. So it is like going into the mirror reflection. And this experiment when she did and very conclusively proved, this was a major path-breaking discovery which changed our understanding of basic physics, and her experiment went long way in doing that. Of course, the if you look at the publications, because she had some setbacks in the experiment, and she was a very meticulous person, wanted to make sure of everything. So she actually did not publish the initial results she did for these experiments over the period of more than a year. She writes in the memoirs that she had come to USA in 1936 from China. In 56, after 20 years, she was supposed to travel back to China to visit the family, to visit the place, to just get back to the, you know, get some glimpse of the personal life, back life, which they left behind. But once this experiment came up and she had to repeat some of the experiments, she had to cancel that journey. And she, when her husband were supposed to go, her husband agreed that she will stay on do the experiments, and he went back. And this again is a very classic case of the family support helps them to work, and this is very, very crucial. So she continued to do the experiments. Unfortunately, the news of this experiments, early results also were shared by others. Some others also did different experiment, and though the results came out together and Yang and Li were given the prize for predicting this idea, she was not given the prize for experimentally proving it. This is again something which is a very clear case that she was a Chinese immigrant plus a woman, and her work was neglected. I will show you one small anecdote. It's getting a bit late, I think, but I have not much more, another 10 minutes. I understand that the movie Mangal Mission predicts a scene. I have not seen the movie, but I've heard this from many people, that where the engineer is while cooking the dinner and she gets an idea and then she rushes to the lab. So here there is an actually a counterpart of the story which Madhumu told about her colleague Marianne Biawati from the group who was also helping them. As I said, she had to make magnetize the cobalt, and which she did by using an housing of these crystals called special crystals or cerium compound crystal, CMN crystal. But at that time they were not able to grow large enough crystal for doing that, and they were discussing this. So the story, the one of the major success of the experiments, or one of the major steps in the success of the experiment, is here. One evening, Marianne took a small glass beaker and some CMN chemicals home with her. While she was cooking dinner, she left the beaker containing some CMN on the stove. As the solution warmed, more CMN dissolved in it. She kept adding more CMN until the solution was supersaturated. And next morning, Marianne brought to the lab a piece of clear CMN crystal about a centimeter in size. And Madhumu immediately realized from here that how now large crystals can be grown. And they made the crystals, and that led to the success of the experiment. And rest is the history. This year, and this is part of the reason I chose Madhumu also, because the, of course, being a nuclear physicist, I am more familiar with their works. But the she was one year working in US in that era, and this year the US Postal Service has released a stamp in her honor on February 11. The citation is given that during a career that spanned more than 40 years in a field dominated by men, she established herself as the authority on conducting precise and accurate research to test fundamental theories of physics. Very, very aptly said. And I would like to quote her granddaughter from the Chinese Daily. I think my grandma would be happy to be seen in this manner, and for young girls to see this stamp and see something of themselves in it. This is very important. See something of themselves in it. Very inspirational for the young generation. Whether it's women interested in STEM, Asian American women, and Chinese immigrants. So either way, I think that's why it will be really, really very inspiring. And thanks to the US Postal Department for such a wonderful and important gesture. In next 5 minutes or so, I want to give you a glimpse of some women scientists in India. Arnab, is it okay if I take 5 to 10 minutes?
Yes, please go ahead. We have enough time.
So the one of the persons in India, and I think some of you would have heard about her, is Dr. Anandi Bai Joshi. She was the first lady doctor in India. Unfortunately, she died very young after she came back from US after studying degree. She had TB and passed away. The reason I also want to mention doctor is that today the medicine in India has a very good gender ratio. In fact, far better than many of the Western countries. It's nearly 50-50. It's also because people prefer women doctor, but it's the society as a whole contributes to it. There's recently a book about her also has come out. There was a TV serial. Of course, you'll have to leave out the dramatization part in the serials, but her story again is very unique and inspiring. A strong support by husband for study. Another scientist I would like to mention is the first woman particle physicist in India, Dr. Bibha Chowdhury. She was the first woman scientist in TIFR, and people remain hidden. I learned about her 2 years back. I feel very, very sad and somewhat ashamed about it because we didn't know about her. She worked with very eminent scientists like Homi Bhabha and Vikram Sarabhai. She also worked with Nobel-winning physicist PMS Blackett for her PhD in England, and has done very interesting work, again experimental work, along with D.M. Bose for discovery, which later led to the discovery of mesons. Her technique, which they had perfected, she and Bose had perfected, was used for the discovery of pi meson, and Powell, who got the Nobel Prize for it, acknowledges that. She also published Nature papers. Again, as I told you, Nature is one of the most valued scientific journal, and this was in the 30s. So the life would have been very, very difficult for her. So I would like to quote one of the chemists from Thailand in Nature journal in 2015, actually featured three Asian women scientists. And in that article, Rohini Godbole, one of the particle physicists from India, who's very famous, and many of you would have heard about her because she also works very passionately for women in science in India, and she has worked a lot for bringing in changes for the women in science in India. She was also featured in that journal. So in words of I hope I pronounce it correctly, Pahanita, becoming a leading scientist involves convincing your family first, and then for the rest of your life going out of your way to prove to everyone that you are actually really good. So that's something which is remains true since it's quoted in 2015, even today, and I really hope it would change in the coming years. Jocelyn Bell says, "For me, being a role model was important. Just to show there are women doing science, enjoying it, and being good at it." And I think this is really something which I remember in this thing, and I think will be very useful for all of us to all the women aspirants to remember. So it's important to raise your own aspirations. Amma Mani, one of the meteorologists in India, said that even a slight error made by her or other woman scientists in handling instrumentation or in setting up an experiment would be immediately broadcast by some men as a sign of female incompetence. This happens even today. Even today I face this, and I'm sure many others face it. But the point to remember is that humans, to err is human. Everybody makes a mistake. We learn from the mistakes, so don't let others put you down. Raise your own aspirations, and the family support and strong mentoring is crucial. This is something which is very, very important. You will see among all those who have achieved something which is there, the family support is important. So my appeal to all the audience, to all, even the male members who are seeing this video or who are attending this lecture, is lend a support hand to your friend, to your sister, to your cousin, whoever is there. Make sure, listen to them, try and understand the problems, and come out in their support. This will help. This will make it really easy for them to move on, and it will make it easy for all of you to go together. Because the gender parity is an inclusive process. Everybody, it's everybody's responsibility. Everybody has to work together to get there. And now to really, this is my second last slide. So I will, this is a picture from Sugra Chunawala, who is the dean at Homi Bhabha Center for Science and Education. So she has this book on gender and science. And this is the concluding part of her book. So I like to quote from that we hope that science and technology will become female friendly. Women will perceive science and technology as being so. This is also important to attract the girls to science. The social attitudes towards women in general and women in science and technology in particular will be more favorable and accepting. This is what will bring about the major changes. So I would like to show two slides, one with some suggested books that you can look up. There are of course some Marathi books, and there are many, many more. I have just put a few as a representative. Lilavati's Daughters, about Indian women scientists. This was brought about by Rohini Godbole and Ram Ramaswamy. Recently, one more book Ram Ramaswamy has brought about is Fragmented Feminism, The Life and Lectures of Anandibai Joshi. Asian edition is available. Vigyan Prasar has brought out a book, Scientifically Yours, on selected Indian women scientists. Savitri Chaleki is, of course, a Marathi book, and Sugra's book I already mentioned. There are two other books, Lisa Meitner, A Life in Physics. I think everybody should read this book. You don't need a physics background. It's really, really a nicely brings, depicts the struggle, and one can only admire and learn from her motivation. If I ever feel that, you know, I'm facing a problem, I actually remember her struggles. Simple things like not having a lab, not being able to go to an institute through the main door, having to have to go through the side door. What a humiliation. And she put up with all of that for the sake of science, for sake of her passion, and did so wonderfully. There are also many talks today available on the YouTube. People who are interested, I would definitely recommend Rohini Godbole's recent lecture, The Legacy of Amy Noether. She was a mathematician, a very eminent mathematician. Many people today think she was, because you hear of Noether's theorem, you think of she was a man. But again, she just did not have a regular position because she was a woman. Shobhana Narasimhan's many talks are on the YouTube, and that gives a very comprehensive view of a situation about women in science. And I would recommend this one from the last year. And just to say that the Indian government and many societies and many people today in academia realize the gender gap in STEM. There are many initiatives taken up, and there's a long way to go, but it's also, I'm also very glad that such initiatives are taken up. These are some of the women scientists from India. Some are practicing, some are from past, this Amma Mani from the past, and these people, Vimala Bhuti, she was the first woman physicist to become a fellow of Indian National Science Academy. Many of you may recognize her. Can anyone recognize her? I'll wait.
Please put it in the chat or put it in the in the comments. At least somebody should recognize her.
That's little unfortunate. She is known as the missile woman of India, Dr. Tacy Thomas. She worked, she was mentored by Abdul Kalam, and she has played a big role in India's missile program, especially the Agni 4, and she is known as India's missile woman. And a lot of about her is available, a lot of information about her is available. So please do look up. I hear something. Yeah, okay. And last year in the Ministry of Human Resources have actually declared 11 chairs to honor eminent women scientists. This is a very, very welcome move by the Government of India, and we really appreciate that. And a lot of these scientists listed here have got recognition. The Vibha Chaudhary I mentioned here, mentioned just now, is there. There are many other scientists whom I could not cover. Kamala Soni, she was also one of the first persons to get PhD. She tried to work at Raman Research Institute. She also was never given a regular student thing there, and she moved finally to the Cambridge to complete her PhD. And now to end my talk, I would like to invite you all to a program tomorrow afternoon. We are going to release the Indian edition of the biography of Dr. Vibha Chaudhary. This is brought out by TIFR and TIFR Alumni Association. The event is planned tomorrow at 4 p.m. available at YouTube. You can join in into the program. And if I hope some of you will be interested in buying the book, so please contact the TFR Alumni or send a mail to either of these addresses for buying the book. And I will now end here. Thank you very much. It was really a pleasure to talk to all of you about the stories of these scientists whom every time I visit, I find very fascinating. Thank you.
Thanks, Vandana. Thanks for the book recommendations as well. So we are now open. We can have a discussion. Maybe you can switch off your screen share while we don't need it. And yes, so if you're on Zoom, you'd like to ask a question, please do. Or you want to say, make a comment, please do. You know, you can either raise your hand, we'll allow you to talk, or you can put it in the chat box. If you're on Facebook or YouTube, please put it in the comment box. We have people monitoring both of them. Dipya, any questions on Facebook? Nishant, thank you. Yes, Nishant says thanks for the book recommendations. Okay, and let's see, anything on Facebook, Dipya?
No, only one comment.
Okay, go ahead. Anything that you want to read out?
Shubhalakshmi Gupta, she says it's so amazing listening to the inspiring anecdotes about this remarkable woman.
Thank you. Yes, as I said, that every time I visit it, I still find something new and inspiring. Yes.
Okay, people on Zoom, do you have questions? Come on, you cannot listen to such a wonderful talk and not had questions about it.
One question just on Facebook.
Go ahead. Read it out, please.
What are the key suggestions to make the world science gender neutral?
Oh, it's a wonderful question, but there is no single solution to that. So there are many things which we have to take care of. So first is, of course, we want to attract the girls to science so that to say that it is possible to do it. Because what happens is, it's the society, culture, everything plays a role in saying that, can you do it? Is it too difficult? People feel that doing experiments is very hard, that will require moving heavy instruments and I will not be able to do it. So these are the kind of doubts people get. So we have to sort of convey to them that that should not be a hurdle. There are ways around it and it can be done. And no way. There is nothing like which says that, the girls or women cannot do this. So that's the one point which is there. The second problem comes more difficult because if you look at in India, that till about graduation, you have a large number of girl students. So what happens is when you go for advanced studies, retaining them, because there are other problems come in. And when you are doing a research career, if you and your husband are in the same job, the same field, then getting the jobs, moving along, adjusting, taking care of children, that is becomes the major responsibility falls. So how to cope up with that? So the programs and the policies have to be made to help with it. The like things like initiatives like child care centers, facilities for the. In fact, nowadays even conferences provide childcare facilities, making it easier for women to participate. So these are some of the things which have to come from the policies as well as from the awareness, and things are changing in that direction. The third and major problem still remains is like if there are age restrictions, because the woman will always have some of the issues like moving, taking care of children, that will put them a little behind in the age schedule. So many times if those are looked as non-productive years, they lose out in academic evaluations, they lose out in reaching the top positions. That's one part. So that is also something the policymakers have to take care. I'm happy to say that in both the national education policy and the recent science technology innovation policy brought out by Government of India has given some thought. I'm not saying that all the questions are addressed or everything will be hunky-dory, but the thought has been given and efforts have been initiated in the right direction. Of course, this is a global problem. This goes beyond India. But the social context and the social problems are somewhat different in different countries, and some of these things are more hindering in the Asia.
Okay, great. Meanwhile, there is a question on Zoom. Malika is asking, did Lisa Meitner perform fission experiments in the underground lab?
No, Malika, Lisa Meitner's time, the underground laboratory was not there. Do you mean her basement lab? If you mean in her basement lab, no. The basement lab, she performed initial radioactivity experiments when she was doing. She also discovered an element.
Malika, you can speak if you want. I have enabled your mic. You can speak. You can just ask.
Yeah, I'm audible?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes, good afternoon. I would like to ask that you mentioned that Lisa Meitner has studied first time for the fission studies, right?
Yes.
So in that context, I would like to ask that is she performed some experiment or she had done something theoretical studies about that or what? I would like to ask.
So the Lise Meitner was doing a lot of experiments in nuclear physics and nuclear radioactivity. Well, as far as the fission was concerned, that the experiment that the neutrons are bombarding the uranium isotopes, that experimental setup was, as I said, this work was joint, was set up by her and Otto Hahn together. Otto Hahn was chemist. So once they do such a experiment, when you get the products, identification of products was done by the chemical method. So this setup, which was set up in her regular lab, her basement lab was in that first institute where she was working in the chemistry. And then I think around mid-1915 or so, she moved to this new institute, which later became Hahn-Meitner Institute. There she had a separate physics lab. Before that, she had a lab in the basement. So in the basement lab, doing the weak radioactivity experiments were difficult. When she moved to this Nuclear Physics Institute, she started doing the experiments on the weak radioactivity, and she actually set up certain protocols about bringing in sources and so on, which may have paved the way for today's radioactive safety protocols. So in that, she had a role in setting up the uranium fission experiment. They had, but the identification of the product, that work was not complete, and that work was done after she left, and that was a chemistry. So all the radiochemistry work, chemistry work was done by Otto.
Okay, thank you.
But she had a role even in the interpretation of the data, that you have to remember. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Malika, if you're satisfied, that's good. Remember, if you want other people on the Zoom, if you want to ask, please, you know, raise your hand. We can unmute you. No problem. Meanwhile, there is a very interesting and a rather, you know, a couple of questions on YouTube. So Joseph Vinod says that there was a paper published in Nature, which got retracted, thankfully, I guess, which said that those who have women mentors, PhD guides, etc., don't have as successful careers compared to those who have male mentors. How could Nature publish something like this? And the question Vinod is asking is this a feeling present in academic circles, and how can we overcome the mentality and encourage more leadership roles for women?
Okay, good question, but it will not have a short answer, so I'll just try to give a brief glimpse to it. Yes, why it's surprising that why such a paper got published. We also have heard that suddenly somebody comes and says that, you know, men are better at maths than women and so on. And these things, of course, do a lot of damage, because even if when people already have some inherent biases, and many times people also have unconscious biases, we do something without realizing, you know, because it's like we buy dolls for the girl children. You'll never think of buying a doll for the young boy. So it's like that, the many, many unconscious biases which are built in, which come in. So it's good that the paper was, of course, retracted with that. But yes, they should be more careful in publishing that. The changing the mindset can only happen again with the involvement of people. So one of the things is that there are a lot of groups which are now, IUPAP, for example, International Union of Pure and Applied Science, has a commission for promoting women in science. There are a lot of women in science engineering groups. When they look at it, this one of the objects, one of their objectives is that to remove or work towards removing biases through the awareness, provide the forum and opportunities to the young women aspirants, make them aware of the opportunities, and the how do you remove or how do you change the mindset of the people? That has to be done through the social education. So we do a lot of workshops which make people aware of unconscious biases and then work consciously to overcome them. So there are gender groups in India also for various sub-disciplines and so on.
Okay, let me move back to YouTube, where there is a very interesting question from Ram Sheshadri. He says that in Scandinavian countries where women have a lot of opportunities and there is, you know, a reasonable equality, women are still not going into science. So is it something inherent in the education system that is not right and not encouraging for women?
Yes, nice question. And it's very true that the Scandinavian countries have a good gender ratio on many things which is there, but it is probably is again something, you know, like when I was doing a postdoc in US, that's almost now 30 years back, I got call for some survey because a person thought that I was actually had been, she had just got a list somewhere and she was sitting, I was sitting, studied in US through school also. The question that surprised her when she said was that if you ask the schoolgirls, so she told me that if you ask the schoolgirls what you want to be, so the most of the girls say that they want to be like, you know, fashion models or something. So it's again a kind of a social stigma or the social cultural part comes in. So in Europe, if you see, I think in Italy and France have more women in science, not the Scandinavia as well. But again, if you go back to Poland, you'll find there are more women in science, because of course when you say this, they say we started with Marie Curie. So it's like that. So yes, it is, there will be a certain social factor and which will contribute. So that identifying that and changing that makes a difference.
Okay, so Ram, I hope that answers your question. Are there any more questions? Let's do a check of Facebook. Dibya, any questions on Facebook?
No, not in Facebook.
Okay, so I would also think that the last question is essentially boiling down to what young women and girls will see as role models in society around them. And unless they see scientists also as role models, it's unlikely that they would be encouraged to take up.
That's very true, Arnab. And one of the jobs which today the institutes and we as a part of outreach team, as well as a part of gender group, or like if you say Indian Physics Association or the women scientist panels of the academy, one of the jobs, one of the goals is that project the role models to the younger community, to the wider community. So it is good. In fact, I would give an example of the, again, something close to my heart, which was that this, if you know, the TIFR ran a summer school for MSc first year women students last year. And the program was online. And advantage of the program being online was some of the lectures, which were like from the women scientists, which were meant to motivate these girls, could also be seen by the parents of these girls or the families. And some of the participants told us that after the lecture, they encouraged their family members to see this. So this is what really then, and I think this is a positive outcome of the pandemic, that we have gone online, increasing our reach through various lectures and these various social media platforms. So this will bring about the projecting role models. So in that case, one more thing I should probably mention is this, Life and Science NGO in India, they also bring out the calendars, they bring out the books. So this again, Vigyan Prasar books really helps in the same way, that project the role models, and which will go towards the motivating and inspiring them. Because I also get sometimes the questions from the parents of the people who young girls who want to study science or maths, that key, I mean, what will their life be like? What will there be career? Will they be able to have jobs? Will they be able to have family? That's always the concern the parents would have. So it really helps to see these kind of things coming out. And when you see a successful woman physicist, successful woman scientist, who are also appreciated, who have made it to the cross the hurdle and reach the top, which is there. So if you go back to my very first slide when I said challenges and achievements, so there it's very important that there is achievement. It's not just struggle. Of course, there will be many who have struggled and not reached as much as they should have. But if they have not reached where they should have, it's the loss to the society, because there may be more people like Agnes Pockel who have done research and we didn't learn that. Now we are reinventing the wheel. If we had known that earlier, we would have gone somewhere ahead much faster.
Okay. Great. So we are at about 12:15, and thank you so much, Vandana, for taking us on this wonderful journey through the lives of people. I don't know how many in the audience would have actually known all these stories. So it was great to be able to hear this. And even if you knew it, it's always great to be able to hear these inspiring things once again.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. And before we end, let me tell you about our next program coming up. Of course, remember, there'll be lots of very interesting talks around Women's Day tomorrow. So, you know, do check out. In fact, given everything being online, there are multiple talks happening at the same time, which is another issue these days. But Chai and Why, our next Chai and Why, 2 weeks from now, this is going to be the Sunday which is closest to Holi. And as always, the Sunday closest to Holi has to be the Chai and Why relating to color. And of course, given the circumstances, this will also be an online only Chai and Why, but we will have something on colorful things. We will do a hands-on session where hopefully you can join in and do some of these things also with us from home. And we will try and do some colorful experiments. That will be our holy session coming up on colorful science around you. That's 2 weeks from now. And on the first Sunday of April, hopefully we will be back in Prithvi Theatre. It just depends on how the pandemic plays out in Mumbai. But till then, please stay safe. You know, wear a mask, get vaccinated if you can, and let's hope that we can get back to our normal China-wise schedules as soon as possible. Thank you so much for joining us and watching.